My name is Bill Abrams, and I'm the president of Trickle Up, and we are very glad to have all of you here tonight to be with us to talk about building economic opportunity and hope for refugees. The UN and the World Bank recently estimated that there are 65 million refugees in the world. So to put that in context, the population of the United Kingdom is 64.1 billion people. So thank you for being here to talk about a problem that is global in scope, and for which there are no easy answers, but there are answers. And that's what we'll talk about tonight. We'll talk about solutions, we'll talk about the work that Trickle Up is doing in partnership with the UN High Commissioner on Refugees, or everybody memorize this acronym, you're gonna hear tonight a lot, UNHCR. And Trickle Up, ever since we were founded in 1979, has always focused on what we describe as the poorest and most vulnerable populations. But through most of our history, the poorest was about economic poverty. More recently, in the last several years, we've also focused on what it means to be both poor in economic terms and vulnerable and marginalized, and has extended our work to developing approaches for households affected by disability, for indigenous populations, which very often face very high levels of discrimination and marginalization. And really about 4 years ago, working with UNHCR, saying what can we do to bring the work we've done, the knowledge we have, the experience we have, to the benefit of people who are living in refugee settings. So that's what brings us here tonight. And I am very happy to particularly introduce our featured guest and featured speaker, Ziad Ayoubi, who has worked with us now, I guess, for 4 years, and has been a great partner. So I will guarantee that when you leave here tonight, you will leave both better informed and more inspired, thanks to Ziad in particular. And to my right, I'm also pleased to welcome back to Trickle Up for another event, Susan Zirinsky of CBS News. She's an executive producer with 48 Hours, and she will be Ziad's conversational partner for the first part of our discussion. And I also want to thank the PIMCO Foundation, a longtime supporter of Trickle Up, and Joyce Chang of J.P. Morgan, and her husband David Robbins for sponsoring this event. A critical factor for success in our work is partnership. And so in addition to UNHCR, I'm pleased to salute some of our partner organizations that are represented here tonight. One is the State Department Bureau of Population, Refugees, and Migration, which recently became a partner with Trickle Up and made a very, very important grant to help us extend our work. Another critical partner is the Consultative Group to Assist the Poor, which is a World Bank-led organization that's been our close partner for a decade everywhere that we work. And there are a number of other organizations here in the room tonight that are doing important work with refugees, so I just want to say thank you for the work that you do. So now I'll turn over my mic to my colleague, Janet Heisen. Janet has been with Trickle Up for 17 years. She was a pioneer in our work with people with disabilities. She was a founding architect of our program in India, which is now growing by leaps and bounds. And for the past 4 years has brought a tremendous vision, leadership, program skills, cross-cultural skills to our work with refugees. And most of all, she has brought an enormous heart, an unflagging dedication to help the poorest and most vulnerable people live lives of dignity and opportunity. So, Janet.
Thank you, Bill. And I'm joining Bill and extending our thanks to you for joining us this evening to learn a little bit more about a really important issue, economic development for refugee populations. You're going to hear another term this evening quite a lot, which is graduation. And so I want to give you a sense of what graduation is. Graduation is an approach that Trickle Up and other organizations use in order to help people living in extreme poverty move out of poverty through a carefully sequenced set of interventions and provisions that move people sustainably towards self-reliance. So the focus is, in all Trickle Up programs, we're working with people living in extreme poverty and providing them this set of services that starts often with a cash transfer. So it helps people living in poverty, whether they're refugees or otherwise, to stabilize their income, to enable them to have have capital so that they can engage in program activities without worrying about how food gets on the table. They participate in skills training. They participate in savings groups meetings. They start livelihood activities that are carefully planned, and they do all this in the accompaniment of a coach. So this is an individual, a mentor, who visits them on a weekly basis or a bi-weekly basis to make sure that they're doing everything that they need to graduate into self-reliance and out of poverty. So that's a term you'll hear. That's a system or a methodology that we're using in various parts, and we're certainly using it with great effect with our refugee population. So graduation and refugees came about 3.5-4 years ago when UNHCR started to learn about the graduation approach, learn about the some research that had been released, and thought it sounded like an interesting strategy for people living in extreme poverty. So it was at that point that I was introduced to Ziad. UNHCR asked Trickle Up to go to Egypt, which was going to be the site of the first project, and to test the graduation approach there and see how it could be modified and changed in order to meet the needs of that population in Cairo. Ziad at the time was working in Egypt and was the livelihoods officer there, and so together we started to plot and scheme what would this strategy look like and how might this be most effective for this particular population in this particular area. So since that time, Ziad has gone on to become the senior livelihoods officer at UNHCR based in Geneva now. He oversees a number of different programs, including graduation, but many other projects that are designed to strengthen economic development for refugees globally. He joined UNHCR in 2012, and before that time was working with a microfinance institution and worked with UNDP for a time in Lebanon as well. So Ziad, we're delighted to have you here. Also joined by Ziad, Susan Zirinsky.
I feel like a loser compared to you. don't read anything else.
No, the problem is that the page should fold out like this for Susan. The credits are long. Susan is an award-winning journalist and producer. I'm the executive producer of CBS's 48 Hours. She's covered national and global news, presidents, wars, international conflicts, the Olympics, and fashion for over 40 years at CBS. She was presented with a Lifetime Achievement Award in 2013 by the New York Festival's International Television and Film Awards. And she's produced a number of documentaries and other special projects as well. Susan, we're delighted to have you here as well. Thank you very much.
That's my cue, right? This is a very special group. And as a journalist who does have a lot of different experiences, it was an honor several years ago to be asked to speak. I think it's actually more of an honor when they ask you back. That definitely has a great ring to it. What was most impressive about this group to me is that you're achievers. At home, in your offices, and then giving your time to develop programs that actually move the needle, that make a difference in people's lives. I was interested when I was reading some background that the Patricof Forum is actually, if you needed any validation that this thing was great, I know Trickle Up is planning to register it as an official UN Assembly side event. That speaks to the power and the impact of the work of Trickle Up. Well, Ziad has recognized the importance, and always, sometimes when you gather together a group that doesn't have to be an enormous group, but it has to be an effective group. And I think that's what he recognized from the things I've read, that you're executors. You can have great ideas in the world you live in, but if you don't know how to execute, it's a lot of talk. And even though those people get attention, it's the people that can actually execute that make a difference. We're blocks away from the United Nations, hours by taxi. But we're blocks away, and even today, Obama convened a small summit of countries where he issued this impassioned plea to do more about, for countries to do more about the refugee crisis and taking in the crisis. You know, sometimes refugees don't get to the front pages. They just get pushed off. It's in the foreign section. Now, they're front page news. Just last week, I think the White House announced that October 1st is their fiscal year, that they're accepting 110,000 more refugees than they did last year. That was a 30% increase from the year before, and a crazy number, that's 57% more than they took in between 2013 and 15, where I think the number was 70,000. Refugees are a major part of this, I can only find one word, bizarre political campaign. We kind of feel the burn, and I don't mean Bernie Sanders. I was a little disturbed, actually, today before I left the office. Somebody handed this to me, and it was a tweet, actually, by Donald Trump Jr. And the tweet says, if I had a bowl of Skittles, and I told you three would kill you, would you take a handful? That's our Syrian refugee problem. And we had, I should have blown up the picture, but I didn't have time. That's a tiny bowl of Skittles. So I think that we're in a particularly tough period of time when we are dealing with this refugee crisis. The other factor is that refugees now generate radical feelings. They give way to fear, and the issue is global, and there isn't a single border. That's why, when I was really reading what Trickle Up had been doing, that I felt that the mission and working with Ziad is so immediate, its impact really can be quite lasting. I work in television, and I work in a world that values things that you can't quite understand why they value. But the refugee crisis, that's the most overwhelming reality show on the planet right now. And I think that for the first time, people may be getting it. I know you talked about the crazy number of 65 million. When I read that the funding gap is 15 billion, it's, you know, that's just an incredible number. And the number that really stunned me was that the average length of long-term for trafficked refugee status is 26 years. It's a lifetime, and sometimes more than a lifetime. So Zia, in my line of work, I would really ask you, even though most of these people are quite knowledgeable, can you give us the wide shot of the current state of the refugee crisis? And if you first talk about the different situations that drive people to leave everything they know.
Thank you very much for coming again. And I'm delighted also to be with you. It's a great crowd, and it's a double challenge that I have today. I was asked to give a little bit of feedback, but not too much feedback. It's very challenging.
We have to keep them interested.
Yeah, definitely, because we are executives, I'm the head of the Livelihoods Unit, so we provide technical support to our country operations on the ground, trying to do a economic empowerment for refugees. Yesterday and today we had great events in Rio, the summit yesterday and today the focus summit, which is, as you said, two big events that are trying to get pledges for refugees ahead. But we need to wait and see what's going to be implemented on the ground. It's a big challenge to translate these commitments into actions. Let's start by putting things in context. So you asked Susan about the volume of the refugee crisis. I want to start by saying that refugee crisis has always been a big issue in the world, but it wasn't in the media. The refugee crisis came to the attention of the media when refugees reached the shore of Europe. Before that, refugees were suffering. Refugees have been suffering in the world since ages. And maybe fortunately in that there is a big attention now in the media, but we need to look at it also from the protracted point of view. That the situations that created the refugee crisis has been always there. Now we are facing 17 wars in the world, and this is what the Secretary General said yesterday in the UN. 17 wars are producing refugees. Every day we have around 36,000 persons are forcibly displaced. So The first point now to put things in context is that we are not starting. We are in the middle of the crisis. The crisis happened a long time ago and it's still ongoing. We have some new events. We have new crises that brought the attention of the media to this global issue that the world is facing. I brought with me some figures. I'm not going to give statistics because you can go to the website and see all of these statistics, but maybe just to start the discussion. You said 16.5 million is the number of UNHCR persons of concern. 21 million among them are refugees, so recognized as refugees and not asylum seekers. So there's a difference between asylum seekers and refugees. Asylum seekers are those who arrive in the country of asylum and ask for protection. They might become refugees and might not, they might be rejected. And there is a refugee status determination process that needs to take place in order to acknowledge that a person is a refugee. So this is a legal process. I'm saying that, I'm not going to go into details also here, but I'm saying that just to maybe mitigate some of the myths that we have in the media also, that yeah, but those people are not refugees. And judgments start to attack people in advance, and some media are even replacing the refugee status determination processes by saying, this is a refugee, this is not a refugee, and this is very unfair. So 21 million are recognized refugees in the world. 10 million are stateless, and UNHCR work on statelessness also. 80% of the refugees in the world currently, as we speak, are in developing countries. So we're talking about Jordan, Ethiopia, Iran, Lebanon, Pakistan, Turkey. Those are the top hosting countries of refugees. So we're not talking about European countries again. UNHCR is present in 126 countries, so you can imagine also the volume of the operation targeting refugees. As I said, 17 worlds are producing 34,000 forced displaced persons every day. Every day we have 34,000 people moving. And finally, a funny story about UNHCR. UNHCR was established in the 50s and was supposed to be working for a couple of months or years, and the budget was $300,000. And it was like an office. Huh? And now we became an agency working with around $6 billion because the world is still producing refugees. So this is a starting point. So we're talking about a huge global issue that came to the attention of the media now. So we need to tackle during this conversation also what happened historically in terms of the response to this issue. The humanitarian response has always been short-term, looking at the relief intervention and making sure that people are accessing quick protection, the emergency.
Well, it always seems that, you know, we're very adaptive people, but and we hope that crises are short-lived. But it feels like now there has been a difference. I know you're saying historically that you've always had these refugees, and perhaps the crossing over into Germany and to Europe has made a big difference. But it does feel that the perception it has changed dramatically, that these are protracted, and this could be Syria, that these people are never going home, which increases the challenges for Trickle Up, it increases the challenges for you. And are we imagining it? Are we in the media not reporting that people have had these protracted issues? It just feels like the refugees now, they're never going back.
Okay, I might avoid saying that refugees will never go back because this is not the case. The three traditional Europe solutions for refugees according to UNHCR literature is either repatriation, which is going back home, voluntary repatriation, it should be voluntary, so people should go back home because the reasons for fleeing is not present anymore. The second option, or the second Europe solution, is the local integration. So wherever they are, they decide to stay, and the government or the state allows them to stay and to integrate in the society. And the ultimate shape of the local integration is the nationalization, to get the nationality of the country. And the third durable solution is very similar to local integration, but in a third country. So people moving from the country of origin to a country of asylum, but after that being resettled to a third country and integrating in this third country. And just to give an example, the US is one of the biggest resettlement operations in the world. So those are the traditional durable solutions, and UNHCR work on achieving these three durable solutions. However, the number of people who can voluntarily repatriate is very limited because of the ongoing crisis and ongoing wars and the reasons of the resettlement also is very limited. We're talking about 1% of the population. So this is very, very limited. So what's the alternative? The alternative is to stay wherever they are. And this doesn't mean all the time a full local integration. Because of many reasons, but usually the main reason that stop people from integrating in the country of asylum is the legal framework and the policies of the host countries. And this is where the challenges are tremendous, because people are staying 26 years, you mentioned. They are always treated as a temporary
and outsiders,
definitely. And they are considered in a transitional situation. And being in a transitional situation means you don't have all the rights that other people have in the society.
But is this is your commission now? Is your job, because the protracted seems to be the norm, is that change the dynamic of your organization and how you work it?
Okay, so UNHCR works on providing, first of all, when the crisis happens, when the influx of refugees happens, UNHCR works on providing the emergency support. And emergency support includes all types of activities, from education, to shelter, to water, sanitation, health, definitely. So life-saving activities are part of the emergency support. But we always look at the refugee population from the protracted point of view, because we know that the length of the of staying in exile is, as you said, 26 years. However, we can't all the time, we can't be efficient in the long term programming, and we need to accept this reality. We are a humanitarian organization. We've been a humanitarian organization for the last 60 years, and our programs are really designed and developed to provide short-term protection and emergency relief. Your question about what's happening now. So what's happening now has been a discussion also for ages, but it was never materialized in a way that the world is starting now discussing this. Bridging between the humanitarian and the developing world has been always an issue for humanitarian organizations. So we deal with people staying for 26 years. But we can't plan for 26 years. We plan for the next 6 months. So we plan for the next 12 months, but we can't plan for longer terms. So what we need as humanitarian organizations, we need development actors to help us and to take over at some point the support that we are providing to refugees. And it's just now that the world is recognizing this need. And in the UN summit, in all the literature that we are having now, we talk a lot about the humanitarian development nexus. How can development actors help humanitarian actors in order to complement the emergency by integrating refugees in the development efforts?
So it's not a life commitment. You're looking for partners to to then move the protracted into another stage, self-sufficiency, integration.
Definitely. As a protection organization, our mandate is very clear. Provide protection and solutions for refugees. But this, in order to be achieved, need also development efforts. If part of the protection is to improve people's lives and build their households economy, this, for example, needs the intervention from local economic development agencies and local authorities, which is not in our hand. It's something that we cannot achieve as a protection organization. So this bridge needs to be rebuilt.
But you, your title, your purpose is the livelihood program. So that, in fact, is a development to put them back into the system, even if the system is a foreign government and not where they were born.
Yeah. So this is a great example. The livelihoods is one of the great examples that show how humanitarian actors can start providing models and can start taking the first step towards development. But there is a limit always. So when we do livelihoods programming in UNHCR, our aim is to, first of all, advocate for the inclusion of refugees in development plans. This is our first aim. We don't want to create development plans in country of asylum. It's not our mandate. But what we are doing is to advocate that refugees should be included in development plans. In addition to advocacy, we need to show that this can work. So refugees could be an active agent in development plans and in development interventions. How can we advocate, how can we show this model? So we do like to use programming in order, first of all, to ensure that refugees are meeting their basic needs. So they are earning money, they are getting employment, they are getting self-employment in order to feed their families in a dignified manner. But at the same time, what we are doing is that we are proposing a model to other agencies, to governments, in order to integrate this model in their program. The work that we are doing with Trickle Up is exactly in this area.
Well, I was going to ask you, because when, how did you, 4 years ago, and they had obviously started to develop a graduation approach, how did you combine the resources? What attracted you to the graduation approach that you believed integrating the two would be a dynamic force for improvement for the refugee?
Yeah. So, as I said, the livelihoods program in UNHCR has been always there. We've been trying since a long time to do activities that aim at creating employment for refugees wherever they are and creating self-employment for them with an ultimate objective of improving their living conditions. 3-4 years ago, we decided to do a reform in this type of programming and to focus on market-oriented programming. Because in the old days, we used to focus on vocational training type of activities, focusing on the supply side of the programming. So now we are looking more at the demand side, at the market, at the private sector, and we started looking at innovative approaches in order to target different refugees populations. The work of Trickle Up came to respond to a major need in dealing with those who are in the bottom of the pyramid. When we do livelihoods programming, there is a risk that we target those who are doing well, somehow viable enough, better off people who can show up and say, I need a business grant, I need a business training in order to improve my business, or I need a job and I have a certificate, so I need a job.
But those, we're missing this bottom line.
We're missing those who are on the bottom of the pyramid. And we were thinking about reaching this category of people with the livelihoods programming, but how can we do that? This was the question. Viability, it's about the preparedness of people to enter into the market. So we had a discussion with Trickle Up, and we learned about what they are doing, and we learned about the graduation model. So the graduation approach is exactly the Livelihoods programming that we are doing initially, targeting those who are doing well. However, it's a very efficient tool to target those who are less confident, ultra poor, they have less capacities, they are invisible somehow, and they need in addition to the technical type of support, they need psychosocial type of support. They need coaching, mentoring, and they need handholding. And this is where we found that the graduation is very relevant to the refugee population. And the relevance points are many. It's not only one relevance point. One of the most important relevance that we found is that the graduation is based on four components. And the first component is the cash, food, health, education, psychosocial support.
Giving them a base.
In order to make sure that they don't slip back into poverty while you are doing their training and all the livelihood support. And this is something, if you want to apply in a new operation, you need to establish, usually. Whereas in UNHCR operations, in most of the UNHCR operations, we have this base component because it's part of our protection strategy. As part of the protection strategy, we make sure that people are receiving a certain type of education, a certain type of health support, cash assistance to meet their basic needs. It doesn't mean that all the basic needs are met. However, we provide a certain level of cash. Food assistance is provided usually by WFP, which is the World Food Program. So, this consumption support is available in the UNHCR operations. So what Trickle Up was proposing to us is to top up this bottom support with the technical type of support, and the most important is the mentoring and coaching, which is bringing people out of poverty in a very careful way and in a very individualized way. So we look at the individual needs of the people.
You recognize them as people because this cast of people had been obliterated, really, ignored by the world.
Exactly, and their graduation is an individualized type of livelihood support. It doesn't look at refugees as a block of people. It looks at the people as individuals. And this is what we call it in the technical, the roadmap for each person. So each person has to have a roadmap with the coach. So they agree on a roadmap, which is an agreement that has steps in order to achieve the self-reliance.
It had succeeded in other places. It was piloted in a number of countries, correct?
Yeah, so definitely. UNHCR, we have created this, Trickle Up piloted this with...
I think you were in, I know, sort of, Burkina Faso, Costa Rica, right, Ecuador. So you had this blueprint of success, correct?
Yeah, these are countries where UNHCR piloted the graduation approach. But even before Trickle Up partnership with UNHCR, this was piloted in Bangladesh in coordination with the World Bank and BRAC Foundation, which is a huge ultra-poverty alleviation program. We are learning from this, and this is what we need to do. So we need to link dots and not to create new systems. So the graduation was piloted. It was a success in the ultra-poverty context of Bangladesh. They managed to alleviate the poverty of millions of people there. So in UNHCR, we said, let's simplify. Let's not create new systems.
Bring it in.
Let's bring it in with a lot of adaptation. So we did a lot of adaptation in the graduation model. Just to give an example, in the Latin America region, in Ecuador, for example, the graduation is not looking only at improving the economic situation of the household. Some of the monitoring indicators that we are using in Ecuador are legal indicators. So we are using the graduation in order to make sure that refugees are accessing the right paperwork to get nationality and ends because the local immigration is allowed in Ecuador. So we're using it as a powerful tool because it has a lot of case management. And the case management can help you in achieving livelihood objectives, but also case management can help you to achieve protection objectives, like sexual and gender-based violence issues are being tackled by immigration, for example, in Egypt, and this is funded by the PRM, the Population and Refugee and Migration Bureau in the US, and it's focusing on LGBT issues, sexual and gender-based violence. However, it's a livelihoods program. So the first objective is to achieve better livelihoods, but secondary objectives are related to gender-based violence,
psychosocial.
So this is one of also of the most important relevance points for us. So we are a professional organization. Livelihoods is one of the protection vehicles. So using a case management approach in doing livelihoods is very relevant to what we are doing.
Do the governments welcome this? Are they, you know, it's as if you're taking a tremendous burden off their hands. You know, who's paying for all this? Is it, you know, does the government contribute? Is it private organizations? I mean, the UN funding? It's a tremendous operation. I mean, how many countries did you say you were in?
So, 126 countries we are operating, but the graduation now. So, let's talk a little bit about the situation of the graduation approach in UNHCR. So we started in 2013, and since then we piloted in 5 countries: Burkina Faso, Egypt, Ecuador, Costa Rica, and Zambia. Those were the tests for us. This year we decided to scale up and to expand. So the expansion will happen in the coming 3 years, about 20 countries. So let's say this is the phase 2, because our ultimate objective is to make a graduation as an approach everywhere we are doing livelihoods. However, we want to go back again to the point that our purpose is not to take over local economic development and do livelihoods everywhere and expand and start mushrooming. The ultimate objective is to integrate refugees in development plans. So one of the things that we try to do, I'm not saying that we are succeeding all the time, but we look for graduation programs implemented by other people, governments, World Bank, NGOs, working on national populations. We look at them and we try to advocate for the inclusion of refugees in their programs. So instead of UNHCR, which is a refugee organization, create a program for refugees, we just integrate people in the programming done by other partners. But this is not easy. This is not happening all the time. Advocacy is very difficult in this area. You said something about the talk. So we have a lot of talks about humanitarian development nexus and integrating the humanitarian population into the development efforts. On the ground, it's very difficult to achieve that. So we have to fill the gap. And it's a gap created by this silent situation that was there since ages. So, to fill the gap, we are doing this programming and we are expanding to other countries. Trickle Up in this area is supporting us in order to provide the technical assistance for our operations to expand and start implementing livelihoods using the graduation approach.
Is there a psychological issue now because of the fear of refugees and the seeds that are being sown? Not only by the politics in the United States, but globally, there is a shrinkage, a conservative threat. I mean, you know, inevitably a refugee surge comes and you have the humanitarian and the moral and the ethical soul-searching parts of the government and general people. But then you have now, much more pronounced, the political and the security questions. How do you deal with that dialectic?
47% of the host countries give the right to work for refugees. So, which means 53% they don't this is a huge obstacle to achieve enabling equality for people. So refugees are human resources. So let's quote the Minister of Refugee Affairs in Zambia. Yesterday, in an event in the UN, in a side event that we organized with WFP, he said, refugees are human resources that could be deployed to boost production and achieve wealth wherever they are. This is what he said. And this is something that we are working with the World Bank in order to prove in an evidence base. Refugees could be an added value to the economy.
It was a study, and this was before the current histrionics of fear of terrorists coming out as refugees. And I mean, it said, and so this was before that, it said, experience has shown how refugees have never been a burden or a threat to the host countries. In fact, refugees have shown extraordinary resilience, creativity, inventing sustainable livelihoods for themselves, and they talked about the added bonus, they become valuable members of the community.
Yeah,
and this was before fear of the of a guy falling asleep in front of a bar and planted two bombs. You know, so
there are many reasons for that, and it deserves, it's worth looking at it, and looking at the research in this area. And there are many reasons why refugee populations are proving day after day that they can produce, and sometimes better than the local population. There are psychological reasons, and it might be important now, but people are living in instability. They don't know what's the future, so they are very keen on working very hard in order to earn their income and to make sure that they have enough resilience to face shocks. So this is an anecdotal somehow. It needs a lot of research, but we're working on that with the World Bank in order to have more evidence. So to return back to the issue of the enabling environment, so this is something that some countries acknowledge, like Uganda, like other countries also, but some other countries have many reasons not to acknowledge this. Political, domestic politics, sometimes electoral campaigns, xenophobic situations lead to a great restriction for refugees' access to the labor market. And this is where, and we use it in our advocacy, this is where refugees will have to work in the informal economy. It's impossible that a state can really stop people from working. This is something that we see everywhere. Even in the most regulated states, people will work. They need to earn their livelihoods. So in this case, people will work in the informal economy, which is a great protection risk for people. Exploitation, harassment, plus for the host country, it brings a lot of negative impact on the economy. All governments are trying to formalize and realize their economies. So it's a little bit controversial. They don't allow refugees to work, but at the same time they want to formalize their economy, which is very controversial. So bottom line, as UNHCR and the club with us, the legal framework is one of the challenges, but it doesn't stop us from supporting people to earn better income and to have better livelihoods. It's a human right for people to work. Freedom of movement and access to work is part of many international instruments. The International Labour Organization, when we discuss it with them, they don't even acknowledge the word right to work. For them, it's a given. The right to work is a given. What we need to discuss here is what are the work facts. So you are in the work labor market, but then what are your rights in the labor market? It's impossible that you are not in the labor market. This is a given. Everyone should have the right to access employment and self-employment. Advocacy is very important. What happened today, again, summit is a great event in the direction of advocacy for the refugees' access. And the Polish summit was about education, resettlement, and livelihoods. Those are the three agenda items that President Obama put on this summit.
To multiple countries.
Yeah, and pledges were done today. So we have many countries saying, I'm going to give refugees 200,000 work permits. They will need to find jobs, and wherever they find a job, we will give them work permits. So this is a great achievement. But as I said at the beginning, we need to follow up. We need to make sure that this is happening. In Jordan,
It's the road app.
In Jordan, it happened. Jordan pledged before to give some work permits, and it is happening. Turkey changed their law. So the labor law was
every
changed. Yeah, but in terms of access of refugees to employment,
right,
in Turkey, this became a reality. Few years ago, it was almost a dream. So this is something that we need to follow up on.
You're seeing the progress.
Yeah, but at the same time, we are doing migrants programs even in places where the government is not allowing refugees to work.
In your future vision for Trickle Up, how do you see that relationship growing?
So, Trickle Up, how can I describe it? It's a small NGO compared to UNHCR, which is a 10,000 person staff organization. It's a small NGO that has a lot of dynamic, and it can really influence an organization like UNHCR. So we have a strategic partnership with Trickle Up. It started in 2013, and it will continue. Trickle Up is helping us to change ourselves. So maybe this is how I can describe it. UNHCR is trying to achieve all the adaptation that we need in order to respond to the volume of the crisis. As we said, we are bridging between the humanitarian and the development. So now we are trying to do multi-year programming. This was a dream in UNHCR before. Our fiscal year is 1 year and everything stops in December. Everything needs to restart in January. So we can't plan for next January. We plan only for this year. We put plans for next year, but nothing is guaranteed. Nothing is guaranteed. It's a 1 year organization. Now we are piloting.
Keeps you aggressive. It keeps you aggressive.
Yeah. Maybe this is a positive point when it comes to efficiency. We're great at implementing programs compared to other UN agencies sometimes, where it takes 1 year to plan. For us, if we decide on an activity, we need to start next January. So this is how we do the work, and Trickle Up knows this very well. So if we have an activity, and it is in next year budget, it needs to start in January because it will end in December. So
I want to give the audience a little chance, but I want to just say one other thing. You know, so often in life, many people go and they never really test it. In the work you do, in the work Trickle Up does, you are facing situations where you are tested every day. And there's a great deal of admiration and awe and appreciation, I think, and sometimes that doesn't come through. So you are doing, as we like to say, the Lord's work.
Yeah, and we are doing mistakes also, and we are learning. So we're learning every day.
Mistakes make you stronger.
Exactly. We're adapting a model that was created to target ultra poor in Asia, and we're adapting it to target refugees everywhere, which means it needs to be now urban, which was not the case before, it was urban only.
Right.
It needs to speak to the cash assistance, which was not the case before. Before it was distribution of assets.
So you have to adapt to every unique situation, every country's kind of internal self.
Yeah,
exactly. Right. I know they want to ask some questions from the audience.
Just to close on the relation with Trickle Up. So Trickle Up happily.
Everybody can stay till midnight, right?
Trickle Up happily managed to get external funding, not yet UNHCR funding, which is exactly what we wanted from the beginning. Scale up in a way that doesn't create any dependence between the two organizations. So Trickle Up happily managed to see to PRM, the State Department Population and Refugee Migration Office. And they agreed on a bilateral partnership, and Trickle Up got funding from the PRM in order to support the UNHCR and to support refugees to achieve better life needs. And this is a model that we really promote, because we should not be the main source of funding for people working for refugees. Refugees are a global issue, and they should be tackled in a global way and not in a monopoly.
Is there just one more? are there other groups that trickle up, or is this a single relationship? Are you not dating other people?
No, definitely. In terms of implementation on the ground of the graduation program.
Right, I know locally, but in the United States and groups like this, is this a unique?
Let's say Trickle Up is the main technical assistance partner in the Livelihoods area. We have other operational partners who are helping us and helping Trickle Up, like BRAC, like the International Labour Organization. So those are great technical resources for us, but maybe the way we partner with them is a little bit different from the way we partner with Trickle Up, where we have an agreement to sign a meeting.
Impressive. Okay, I promise I'm stopping. Questions from the audience?
The other 53 are, can you give us a sense of how they size up? Is it 53% of GDP or 53% of countries? And is it the bigger countries that are resistant to the integration process, or smaller? And how does it work with education, which is obviously a key for, you know, solving the problem in a sustainable way? Exactly, to the education system also.
One by one.
I'm not answering things if you are. I have a lot of expertise. This isn't my area.
So, yeah, so I didn't mention that even among the 53%, there are also issues. So even if a country has its own legal system, the right to work is acknowledged for refugees, with the implementation, we are facing a lot of challenges. I can give a lot of examples where, for example, in the legal system, refugees have the right to open a bank account, but when they go to the bank doesn't accept to open the account for them because they don't acknowledge their ID card. They don't have the same ID card of nationals, which means consequently that they are in fact and they are not open an account. In many places, for xenophobic reasons, refugees are not able to access the labor market, even though the law allows them to do that. So the number 4753 is quite theoretical. Usually, we count very quickly, 1, 2, 3, 4, the number of countries where the access to the labor market is really granted to refugees. And in all the other countries, it is somehow limited, even though the legal system allows. Now, speaking about other areas of support, like access to education, it's a bit less problematic than the language. I'm not saying that it's fine, but let's say language is the most problematic areas of access. Because usually it's perceived by governments as a competition issue with the national population, and it creates a lot of public opinion issues. So they just want to avoid it. Where education is more perceived as a short-term thing, it will not affect the life of other people in the country.
I'm going to pick up on
your question. You asked if there are other organizations like Trickle Up in the U.S. My question goes to the world of art. There's a sense that, you know, the U.S. steps in whenever there's a problem. I was curious that, are there other organizations outside of the U.S., whether focused on livelihoods or otherwise, that are stepping up to the refugee crisis?
Similar to Trickle Up, whether it's Germany, France, any of the government.
Among the things, there are many organizations, non-US-based. I can give a lot of examples also. The Swedish International Development Agency, which is a governmental organization funded by the Swedish government, is establishing what we call the Credit Guarantee Facility. It's just to summarize it, it's a financial instrument that will help microfinance institutions to give loans to refugees. So any microfinance institution in the future willing to give loans to refugees will be covered, 50% from their list will be covered by the CEDA. So if they lose money, CEDA will reimburse them 50% of their loss. This is a great initiative that is taking place now. The first test will be next year. We have many other partners, even private sector partners like IKEA. IKEA is very active in supporting livelihoods for refugees. The Danish government also is doing a lot of work with us on that.
I have two questions. The first question, you mentioned that you need to gain a refugee status. How long it takes, and is it very complex to get a refugee status? And the second question, you mentioned that you give people cash. If they don't have bank accounts, how do they get the cash, and how does people function within the economy?
The
practical
question.
Okay?
Yeah.
Thank you for this question. Technical and practical. So the first question about the refugee status determination, RSD. So this is a new one. RSD, usually, theoretically, RSD should be done by governments and not by UNHCR. So when asylum seekers enter the territory, they are registered by the government, and the RSD is being done by the government. It takes sometimes, in some countries, it takes a month, 2 months. In other countries, it takes years to get your RSD done, which means after 2-3 years, some people are informed that they are not recognized as refugees and they have to leave the country. Even after staying 3, 4, 5 years in the country, no integration, only temporary residence, and then at some point you are rejected. You need to leave the country now. So, in this case, UNHCR, the 51 Convention protect those who are acknowledged and recognized as refugees. Those who are rejected, if they did all the appeal process and they are still rejected, they become migrants and they are not anymore asylum seekers or refugees. Now, who is doing that? In most of the developing countries, it's UNHCR who's doing the RSD because there's no capacity in these countries to do that. So they ask UNHCR, governments ask UNHCR to conduct the RSD, and in some places it's very problematic because it takes very long to finish the case load to do the RSD for everyone. In some countries we have a backlog of 2 or 3 years, so people, if they arrive now, they get an appointment for an interview after 3 weeks. And this is one of the areas where we are looking at innovative ways. How can we do things differently? Because we cannot continue doing as
they
do.
They
get assistance, definitely. They get assistance. Now, the question of cash to post office, from post office we move to bank accounts, then ATM cards. In some places, it's very advanced. Again, the case of Jordan, we use iris scans, which is people go and take the iris scan and get withdrawal money. So it's a very advanced way of managing identities. in order to limit fraud and limit protection risks also.
If you only have time for one more question, from the gallery. So, maybe more broadly, I was curious as to how have you seen the issues of refugees change over time, and you know, how has UNHCR and the partner institutions that you work with change their focus and expertise, and what's most useful to you going forward as you think about that from your own strengths and you know, the strengths of your partners?
So, the change. Now, talking about livelihoods programming, the main change that we are doing is, as I said at the beginning, we are moving from focusing on people's capacity to look at the market in a broad way. So what we need now is to be more able to do the right analysis of the market and to do the right stakeholder analysis also and the value chain analysis where we operate in order to make sure that we are pushing refugees to integrate in the right markets and in a safe way. So this is something that we are really focusing on now. We're building our internal capacity and we are working with all our partners on the ground to build their capacities also in this specific area. How can we do market-oriented livelihoods programming? Just a funny example, a long time ago we used to do a lot of vocational training. Yeah, so we give this example all the time. And vocational training was almost in advance known what's the topic. Either haircutting or tailoring or sewing. And we used to distribute sewing machines to women and we used to distribute toolkits to men who were to do their haircutting. And we used to graduate thousands of people to do that. And this was in the 80s, 90s, and I mean, it's good to acknowledge that this was the start of the livelihood, and it's everywhere. So those who are working in NGOs here, and they are often asked your colleagues, they used to do the same. So all NGOs, humanitarian NGOs, used to do this. And we were assuming that this will lead to employment. It's like haircutting is a huge profession that is thousands of people. And people were getting the tools and just putting it in the salon and not work and not integrate in any market. This is something that we are completely stopping. So we are stopping these programs everywhere we are working because it's very risky. It's really disappointing. People are getting frustrated from these programs. And it's a waste of money at the end of the day. So we are not wasting money on these programs anymore. And Trickle Up is helping us in looking at the markets also, plus other organizations like ILO, as I said, international labor organization. It's the main partner for us to look at markets and value chains.
Thank you. You know, one of the themes of this evening is about the myth, the misinformation, and all the falsehoods that travel around the world and all the dialogue right now on immigration and refugees. So I hope everyone who leaves here tonight with more information. Another myth that's all too common and needs to get debunked is about the United Nations. People are very quick to say the UN fails at this and can't do that. And I hope tonight one of the things you've seen will go away thinking about and inspired by is the work that UNHCR, the UN Refugee Commission, does. You're not impressed and inspired by Ziad and their determination and their willingness to innovate and take chances and do things differently and work really hard to take on the difficult challenge of addressing the needs of 65 million people, mobilizing a large, yes, bureaucracy of 1,000 employees and $6 billion budgets around change, around success, around learning, around making things happen. So among other things, I know I'm leaving here and I started from it, with an extraordinarily high respect for the work that UNHCR is doing. We are enormously proud and privileged to be their partner in this. It's a long process, and as long as either Ziad and Janet and others who work on this with us, I think we can see real change. So I thank you for the work that you do and the agency's doing, and I thank you for coming here tonight and being a part of this conversation. And Susan, thank you very much for your effort.